Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of True Alignment, linking company culture with customer needs for extraordinary results, by Edgar Papke. Narrated by Don Hagen. Preface. This book represents the first time a comprehensive framework is provided for exploring in a simple way how we all participate in the art of business. It brings together, in a comprehensive and understandable approach, various aspects that are generally written about and presented separately, including the customer, product and market strategy, branding, organizational and team cultures, and leadership. This approach is easily applied to any business situation and ties together all the elements in a consistent view of what motivates us to engage in business in the ways we do. As a customer, employee, CEO, business leader, manager, or entrepreneur, you'll recognize yourself in this book. True Alignment is also the first book to provide a measurable and observable approach to aligning the customer to a company's culture and what makes this distinctive relationship work. In writing this book, one of my goals is to provide a framework that can be applied to any aspect of business, allowing you to determine when alignment exists and when it doesn't. This includes how alignment affects whether you are satisfied or dissatisfied as a customer, a happy or an unhappy employee or team member, or a self-actualizing leader or entrepreneur in pursuit of a business strategy and culture that aligns to your personal motivations and influence. Everything in life is personal and an aspect of our individual and shared human experience. As you read about the various aspects of alignment, you'll very likely find yourself exploring your own personal and intimate relationship to the art of business. As a result, I invite you to find new ways in which to see yourself and better understand the choices you are confronted with every day and why you make the decisions you do. My belief is that you will find this very empowering. At the very least, you'll find it thought-provoking. Another unique feature of this book is the range of examples providing insightful stories about how alignment leads to success. Often, business books focus on what makes larger organizations and corporations more competitive and successful, often leaving the reader with insights that are only useful within the context of larger companies, and frequently only of use to those in leadership positions. Or books focus on the more tactical aspects of entrepreneurial pursuits for the owners of smaller businesses or one-person companies. I have intentionally included examples of smaller companies and businesses, as well as those of some of major multinational corporations and brands you are familiar with. What you will find is that the alignment framework in this book applies to all businesses, regardless of their size, market, and origin. This makes this book valuable to any reader, in any role. Finally, this book is unique because of its timing. Over the last century, how we engage in the art of business has dramatically changed and has, as a result, changed our world forever. My sense is that this is a good time to examine how and why we've arrived at the business society of today and how we can better prepare ourselves for the future. We are at a critical time. It is very likely that each of us has some level of distrust in our current relationship to business. I believe that we can realign our relationships to business and rediscover the trust required for the successful future of our business society. By the time you reach the end of this audiobook, you'll likely conclude that alignment is the key to business success, whether in the form of purpose, vision, strategy, branding, culture, and who we all are as customers. It is the most important conversation among businesses and their leaders, teams, and employees. This applies to everyone worldwide. Alignment is the ongoing conversation that leads to success. Alignment is the conversation. That being said, welcome to the conversation. Introduction. It's all about alignment. The key strategic imperative of any business is alignment. Alignment has long been the greatest challenge of leadership. Its importance, along with its effect on performance, has only increased over time. Today, to come close to competing and succeeding in the chaotic and rapidly shifting business environment, leaders must create aligned teams and organizations. For extraordinary companies, those that consistently compete and win in the marketplace, the overriding characteristic that is invariably present and separates them from their competition is alignment. And because it is so important, the challenge is all the more difficult. Most leaders, teams, and companies struggle with alignment because until now, they lacked an effective and easy-to-apply framework and approach. As a result, they tackle individual aspects of business, such as vision, strategy, processes and systems, and culture, without aligning them. The following chapters will introduce you to the business code, a framework for alignment that can be applied to any organization or team, regardless of its size. It will show leaders and their companies how to confront and overcome the challenges of misalignment. The code also provides the tools needed to create strategies and initiatives and take actions that result in the alignment required to compete and achieve high levels of performance. The outcomes of applying this framework include alignment that clearly defines the trusted relationship of the business to the customer's expectation, and what the brand stands for. Alignment of leadership that is responsible for role modeling, reinforcing, and leading an aligned culture, and is committed to the reputation and success of the business. Leaders who hold themselves and other leaders responsible for their personal alignment to the organization, as well as its vision and its culture. Alignment of goals and strategies across and down through organizations and teams, large and small, demonstrated by the contribution each group and team member makes to the organization's vision and strategies. Alignment of each individual to the values, beliefs, and expectations of the culture. Each member knows how success is created at individual, group, and company-wide levels. Alignment that results in every person being responsible and acting in alignment with the business's intention, as conveyed through each member's commitment to the customer. Alignment that contributes to the resilience that great companies and teams demonstrate when confronted with difficult issues and challenges, and keeps them from going off course or losing sight of their mission, vision, and intended outcomes. Alignment that is demonstrated through every decision and action taken by every member of the organization or team, how they fit into its culture, and what the company and team have promised to deliver to the customer. The dangers of misalignment. Most of us are all too familiar with the consequences of misalignment. We get caught up in the conflicts and blame games that result when everyone is not working toward the same outcome. Time and energy is wasted trying to overcome misalignments, which can disrupt and destroy teamwork and eventually bring down entire companies. The consequences of misalignment are grave. Among others, they include a lack of focus on results that support the vision and strategy of the team and organization, resulting in poor performance. A lack of a shared and consistent approach to serving the customer, which damages the company's reputation and brand and creates customer distrust. A lack of the ability to leverage and fully utilize team members' individual talents and strengths, which decreases motivation and reduces their desire to contribute. A lack of clear expectations resulting in unmet performance requirements, poor accountability, distrust, and potentially divisive conflict. A lack of responsibility and mutual accountability among team members that results in the loss of trust and commitment to individual and team performance. A lack of open communication, resulting in finger-pointing, poor conflict management, and dysfunctional behavior. A lack of aligned approaches to problem-solving, decision-making, role definition, and processes and procedures, causing confusion and disengagement. a lack of teamwork among leaders that cascades through an organization, which results in conflict, an us versus them attitude, and inability to perform at the required level. Clearly, misalignment is costly. Typically, a negative financial impact results, which can be obvious or often hidden. Among the hidden costs are unmet goals and objectives, missed opportunities, missed sales, unmet promises to the customer, and a myriad of other failures that result from dysfunction within a group, team, or company. One way or another, misalignment results in a failure or a lack of execution, which has a negative financial impact on a business. All too often, leaders find themselves searching for answers to these problems without realizing that misalignment is at the root of them. They instead rely on hit-and-miss approaches and fixes, as well as temporary measures that provide only short-term solutions. Obviously, the consequences of misalignment are too many and too powerful to ignore. Therefore, leaders must focus on the challenge of creating and leading aligned teams and organizations and view it as an opportunity to improve performance. Great leaders and team members actively seek out and confront misalignments. The path of alignment. Recognizing that alignment is the greatest challenge leaders face is only the beginning. The ongoing effort of aligning people to work together to contribute to and accomplish a set of shared outcomes and goals requires knowledge and well-developed leadership competencies. The most difficult job is managing and leading others. At the root of the failure of organizations and teams to perform is the inability of people to work together in support of one another and their shared goals. No one accomplishes anything without the help of others, and working together toward a shared goal requires alignment. To begin effectively aligning and leading their organizations and teams, leaders must clearly and consistently address the what, why, and how of the company. If this were easily accomplished, being a great leader would be much less demanding, less difficult, and less valued. This is what makes alignment the single most important aspect of leading in today's complex and fast-changing world. Whether you are a CEO, business owner, manager, or team leader, it is not only your greatest challenge, it is your calling. The what, the why, and the how are the three questions the business code addresses. Too often people are unclear about what they are contributing, are disengaged emotionally from why they are doing it, and confused and fearful because they don't really understand how they are supposed to do it. Extraordinary companies and teams are those in which the what, why, and how are aligned. They have a clearly articulated and understood vision of what they want to accomplish. They know what the desired outcomes are and are able to innovate to continuously create and deliver a product or service that reflects and aligns with the customer's expectations. Their people are emotionally engaged because they know why what they're doing matters and the benefit it brings, believe in what is being created and care deeply about it, and have a shared sense of purpose and feel responsible for their contribution to making it happen. They are aligned on how to work together to achieve results. They have a plan or strategy. More important, they know the steps in a process, system, or procedure, and act in alignment with the values and beliefs of the organization or the team's culture. For several reasons, why is currently getting the most attention. There is widespread concern over the lack of employee engagement in larger companies. A second, less obvious reason is that customers buy products or services to fulfill individual needs. To succeed, a business has to align those working for it to the emotional aspirations of the customer. Today's complex and fast-paced world leads businesses to focus on finding a solution that offers the best return. It's much like getting someone's mind share. This often keeps them from seeing that there's more they could do and benefit from. Last, as businesses and consumers, we seek greater meaning from what we produce, sell, and buy, and the significance these have to our quality of life, social benefit, and environmental impact. This, along with the abundance of options, leads us to look for less complex choices and simpler yet more powerful solutions. Simplicity and alignment are not mutually exclusive. When all three components of what, why, and how are present, a company or team works well. Leave one out, and things become complicated. The alignment of the three is the true source of extraordinary performance. Place too much emphasis on one, and a leader will soon run into trouble. Therefore, leaders need to remember the importance of and pay attention to each. This begins with clearly communicating the what, the vision, goals, and outcomes the organization must accomplish to compete and be successful, defining and leveraging the emotional motivators of why, and articulating the how. What? I often see leaders with a clear vision of what they want to accomplish. They articulate and share their vision and goals with the members of their company or team. They may even have a well-defined roadmap and lay out a set of measurable outcomes with key performance indicators intended to challenge their group. Yet people still don't take the initiative to get the job done. When this happens, leaders are disappointed and wonder why the team doesn't exude the same energy and commitment that they do. They question why there is conflict among team members about who is responsible for what, who has the authority to make decisions, how roles are defined, or how people are expected to communicate and share information. They have a great idea of what they are supposed to do, yet they lack the emotional commitment and an understanding of how they will work together to achieve the intended outcome. The leader and team members are clear on the definition of what. However, they lack the emotional why and a description of how to work with one another. Why? Throughout my career, I've coached many leaders who are able to charismatically engage others in a cause. They connect with and draw on people's emotional motivation. Unfortunately, a reliance on this component can result in a false hope that a shared sense of purpose and mission will emotionally engage people and result in success. The hope is that if there is meaning and everyone shares in why, what will organically emerge, and the team will find a way to work together to get it done. While it's inspirational to believe that this can happen, it's rare for it to do so. In fact, when it is successful, some form of individual or shared leadership has usually emerged to provide a framework for the clear articulation of a measurable outcome and the steps needed to achieve it. More often, while everyone puts forward his or her own best intentions, the group has difficulty reaching consensus about what the members need to produce to best deliver the shared cause. The result is a lack of agreement and cohesion about how things are done. The group has the why, yet lacks the what, and therefore cannot know how to achieve it. How? Over the last 20 years, leaders have learned to pay attention to culture and go beyond the surface definition that is about processes and systems. In addition, although most leaders appreciate the role of values and beliefs in defining culture, most still don't possess a framework for articulating, observing, or measuring it. Therefore, they can't intentionally lead their cultures. This is important because culture is the true how. It defines how people treat and work with one another, including how they are expected to act and what is considered acceptable and unacceptable behavior. Culture provides the framework for how people live the values and beliefs of a group, how they gain and use power and influence, and how planning occurs, decisions get made, roles get defined, and conflicts are dealt with. It also explains their responsibility to one another. Culture holds the key to defining trust and respect. Still, if leaders focus only on culture and expect the what and the why to emerge, they miss the other benefits of alignment. The leadership and a team or company that performs to its true potential must have an emotional and cognitive connection to what it intends to achieve and why it exists. Because business is a human art, the why and how extend far beyond the processes, systems, and step-by-step actions people take to create and deliver a product or service competitively to the marketplace. At the core of the relationship between provider and buyer are the why and how of their emotional connection. This applies not just to the product or service, it also applies to the emotional affiliation the customer has to the organization's culture and its brand. When aligned, trust is manifested and sustained, and the provider enjoys the benefits of brand loyalty. Alignment's power and influence also applies to the people responsible for delivering a competitive offering to the customer. It defines how they communicate, cooperate, and collaborate. It also provides the basis of the customer experience. How are a company's tenets of trust, its values and beliefs, expressed to the customer? The alignment of internal behavior to the external experience of the buyer results in loyalty that lies at the core of successful competition. When leaders and team members focus on alignment, they connect and integrate the various elements that make a great business work, including aligning the intention to the customer and brand, vision and strategy, and the business's culture and how it is led. Whether it pertains to the customer relationship, service, product development, operational capability, or human resources, focusing on alignment engages leaders in questioning and challenging how strategies and initiatives support the organization. Alignment is a key source of innovation and creativity, the building of one idea upon another. It creates an environment in which people communicate at broader and deeper levels and increases the opportunity for the exchange of ideas. When we leverage alignment across a team and organization, we take critical thinking and problem-solving to higher levels, resulting in increased innovation, creativity, and better performance. As we look to the future, learning to apply a framework for alignment will continue to be the key skill and competency of great leaders. Leaders can no longer focus on just one aspect of or strategy for change, or on a particular facet of product, service, or market development. This will become more evident and powerful if we are to successfully compete in a global marketplace in which the speed of change and complexity continues to grow. This book offers an opportunity to assess and actualize the strategies that will enable you to better lead and contribute to the alignment of your organization and team. The business code provides insight into what motivates customers and how human needs are fulfilled. It will help you understand how brand intention provides the platform for the alignment of deliverables to the customer, and how that entices the customer to buy and results in brand loyalty. We'll then turn our attention to culture, a subject that challenges even the greatest of leaders and companies. We'll explore how the patterns and norms of behavior bring values and beliefs to life, and guide organizations and teams in how they create and deliver a product or service to the customer. You'll discover how cultures are influenced and how to measure and observe the alignments and misalignments that hold back a team or company's ability to reach their desired levels of performance. Next, we'll investigate the influence of leadership on brand intention, strategy, and culture, and the importance that leadership development plays in successful alignment. What motivates leaders is key to understanding the dynamics of how team members engage one another and the customer. Whatever your role, customer, contributor, employee, team member, leader, or CEO, you are influenced by alignment. 1. The human art of business. Business is the most advanced form of human art. We all engage in business. Every day we take part in business. It may not be obvious, yet from the moment we wake, we are consumers by turning on a light, running water, dressing, eating breakfast, gassing up the car, stopping for coffee, and of course, texting and emailing. Throughout the day, you engage in activities that contribute to the creation and delivery of a product or service. By all accounts, business is the most advanced art form that we engage in. All other forms of art rely on the ability to create and do business. Without commerce, they are unable to sustain, grow, and advance. Eventually, all other art forms evolve into businesses. Music, design, fashion, photography, theater, and film are industries. Business has brought a level of innovation and creativity to these art forms, and how they, in turn, are used to conduct and promote business. Viewing business as art helps us understand how it became the source of so much innovation, creativity, and influence. This approach also helps us understand what motivates us, the ways we participate in business, and the roles we undertake, such as customer and consumer, advocate and marketer, inventor and designer, customer service representative, marketer, salesperson, process and systems creator, and financial manager. Finally, of course, there is the role of leader. A great place to start unraveling the question of why we participate in business is to explore our motivation. The answer is simple. It is the force of human emotion, which results from our desires and how we feel about meeting them. When our needs are met, we feel content and behave in a way that will further that happiness. When our needs are not met, we feel angry, upset, or disappointed. As a result, we're likely to behave in a manner we think will get us what we want. This can include withdrawing, looking for sympathy, blaming others, arguing, or threatening. All are aimed at overcoming our anger or disappointment and influencing others to meet our desires. Bacon and eggs, anyone? Here's a list of 12 of the most influential business people in recent history. Is there any name you're not familiar with? Bill Gates, Oprah Winfrey, John D. Rockefeller, Henry Ford, Mark Zuckerberg, Walt Disney, Coco Chanel, Thomas Edison, Warren Buffett, Edward Bernays, Steve Jobs, J.P. Morgan. The odds are fairly good that Edward Bernays is the only unfamiliar name. Who is he, and why is he included? The answer tells us something about how marketing and advertising reached such a sophisticated level of influence. The idea that we purchase products to fulfill our desires and that our buying decisions are based on emotions rather than logic is certainly not new. While several versions of how this evolved exist, they all involve Bernays, an Austrian-born immigrant to America who is considered one of the most influential minds of the last century. Bernays, who is known as the father of public relations and the father of spin, pioneered public relations. He provided the foundation for emotional selling and marketing and influenced much of the 20th century's economic and political thought. In the mid-1920s, the Beechnut Packing Company saw its revenue from bacon sales lagging and turned to Bernays for help. Before Bernays, the assumption was that people used logic to make decisions. Bernays, however, was influenced by his uncle, Sigmund Freud, who believed that people are more motivated by emotion. Thus, Bernays understood that much of human behavior is driven by instinct and unconscious desires. As a result, he believed that appealing to the public's emotions would result in greater sales than promoting the dependability and reliability of a product. Thus, to sell more bacon, Bernays decided to create an emotional appeal for a heartier breakfast that included bacon. In the mid-1920s, the ideal American breakfast was toast, juice, and coffee. To change people's thinking, he asked over 4,500 physicians whether they thought a light or a hearty breakfast was healthiest. The physicians overwhelmingly chose the hearty breakfast. Bernays' idea of a hearty breakfast included bacon and eggs, so he used this definition when he released the findings of his study. The news made headlines. Within a short time, bacon and eggs became America's breakfast. Beechnut Packing enjoyed a significant increase in bacon sales, and breakfast was redefined. Bacon and eggs, or some variation, remains by far America's best-selling breakfast. This includes McDonald's McMuffin. Bernays' contribution remains incredibly powerful. The idea that what we buy is driven by emotion is how products or services are marketed, branded, and sold today. Automobile sales play on motivating the buyer's desire for freedom, luxury, pride, and appearance. Clothing and accessories are marketed to reflect sexual prowess, attractiveness, and status. Food marketers promote physical well-being, goodness, and for foodies, feeling in on the latest trend. Bernays' ideas have been advanced, expanded on, and fine-tuned, and emotional selling is still with us. Whenever you hear doctors recommend or more dentists recommend, you have Eddie Bernays to thank. Back to basics. At the most fundamental level, the goal of any business is to provide a product or service that responds to and fulfills our needs. It is why we engage in business and buy the products or services we do. What we buy is the result of our motivation. How we do it reflects the process that delivers it to us. To better understand this, we must explore what motivates us to engage one another to fill a need. For example, to fill our need to feel connected and accepted, we engage in communities which give us a sense of belonging and tribal identity. These communities include religious and civic organizations, clubs, and schools. These are businesses, as are the enterprises, organizations, teams, and work groups, professional associations and affiliations, and the social media we participate in. As we'll explore in Chapter 3, this need is at the core of some of today's most successful products or services. To fill the need for accomplishment and the status that accompanies it, we strive to be successful. Our achievements allow us and others to see us as able to reach high levels of performance. We compete to be the best, the smartest, the most knowledgeable, and the most skilled. In business, we compete with one another in the hierarchies that are part of our work groups, teams, and organizations. We demonstrate the rewards through the products or services we buy and the social merit we contribute. To fill our need for self-actualization, we engage in personal development and growth, such as the study of spirituality, religion, and self-awareness, to be in harmony with the world, to be at peace with ourselves and others, and to find self-acceptance and love. We may also be customers of businesses that provide opportunities for self-discovery, personal growth, and power, and that assist us in our pursuit of abundance. To fill our need to be conscious of our environment, we engage in practices that are eco-friendly. We choose goods and services that lessen our footprint and restore what we've taken from the earth. We create technologies and products that diminish the impact of pollution, and in some cases, eliminate the loss of natural resources. From the upstream bio-friendly and safe products to the downstream providers of recycling services, we participate in protecting and improving the planet. To fill our need to be helpful and compassionate, we engage in activities and contribute money and other resources to causes that alleviate hunger and poverty and help others in times of crisis. These examples provide insight into human nature and what motivates us to participate in business as we do. Our understanding and ability to apply the elements of the business code helps us interpret why we buy, what we buy, and how we do it. The more a product or service fulfills a need, the more we are attracted to it. The greater our attraction is, the stronger the offering. The stronger the offering, the more powerful the brand. The more powerful the brand, the more value the product or service has. We like winning. I often ask audiences, why are you in business? What is it you're trying to do? The most frequent and confident response is to make money. That's not a wrong answer. There's a great deal of truth in it. After all, one of the measures of business success is profit. Profit is part of the end game, the scorecard. Making money is the measuring stick of capitalism. In my view, the purpose of a business, regardless of the product or service and whether it's a for-profit or not-for-profit enterprise, is to win the customer. That's what business is all about. I then ask, what do you offer the customer that allows you to be successful and make money? Answers include superior customer service, added value, a product our customer can depend on. We give them quality. I offer them something they can't get anywhere else. We provide expertise, a wide selection of options and choices. We give our customers peace of mind, to bring value to people's lives. We provide solutions, helping our customers reach their goals. It's interesting when members of the same team give different answers. If there's going to be misalignment among members of a group and a conflict over who is right and who is wrong, this is where it starts. Winning the customer is the result of delivering a product or service in a way that motivates the customer to buy it. They choose to spend their money on your offering rather than on someone else's, your competitor. Competition is a key driver and motivator of business. The foundation of our capitalist system is our shared desire to compete. The winners reap the benefits, so it is natural that we compete to win. When a customer pays enough for your product or service to make a profit, you can invest that profit to increase your ability to win and build your business to win even more. Winning isn't our only motivation. Several others contribute to our propensity to participate, including the social benefit we create and deliver. A powerful aspect of an organization's alignment resides in what is being created and delivered. Behind every product or service, there is a purpose, a reason why the product or service has value. Finally, there is how the product is created and delivered to the customer. These three are the centerpiece for what it takes to win in business, and together they provide the foundation for how the four elements of the business code come together. In the next chapter, we'll explore how these forces influence the cultures of our teams and organizations, engage us in our leadership preferences, and result in the consistent thinking and behavior business demands. 2. The Business Code. At the heart of complexity lives simplicity. Aligning a business, company, or team requires a clear and constant focus, continuous effort, and all the skills necessary to be a great leader today and tomorrow. Members of organizations and teams must be more engaged and committed than ever before. For this, they need as much information and development as their leaders do. Every member of every team or company has a role in ensuring that alignment exists. Businesses become ever more complex as the speed of change increases. Too often, we remain committed to old ideas and methods embedded in the last century's management thinking. The degree to which we've internally focused on the creation and maintenance of often disconnected processes and systems adds to the misalignment of companies or teams. The future seems increasingly unpredictable. Our sense of safety is eroded, and our expectations for stability are harder to fulfill. The promises of the past are vague remnants of motivations that are no longer credible and carry little influence in today's workplace. Many shifts in the workforce turned out to be greater than most people expected, thereby creating uncertainty. Four generations are now part of an increasingly diverse workforce. They have differing perspectives and expectations. The global marketplace, once confined to geographic delineation, is melding and shifting. With it, a global workforce demands mobility and opportunity. The changing face of society is only outpaced by the changing face and increasing turnover in personnel. Bookstores and the internet offer endless products and streams of business ideas and approaches to leadership. The varieties and choices available for strategic implementation are mind-boggling. If you add the availability of technology, information, and the speed of communication, it's easy to understand that the level of focus and commitment required to create and lead alignment can be overwhelming. To confront this challenge, leaders need a systemic framework for understanding, assessing, and creating alignment. They and their teams and organizations require an approach that cuts through the complexity and eliminates the noise from multiple priorities, numerous initiatives, and the confusion of choices and options, an approach that provides a clear and simple roadmap to success. The business code starts simply, letting us discover the richness of how business fulfills our needs. It allows us to connect the needs of the customer to our brand's intention, as delivered through the products or services provided. Next, it connects the ways in which we lead and operate our businesses and shows how they can be aligned to become more effective and efficient. There are four elements to this systemic approach: the customer, brand intention, culture, and leadership. The framework provides a measurable and observable means of articulating and aligning company culture to customer expectations. This particular alignment presents a significant challenge. For most leaders, their organization or team's culture is defined through values and beliefs, and then further interpreted by the individual. In meeting this challenge, the business code provides a comprehensive lens through which to view the patterns of behavior by which culture can be intentionally led. It provides a systemic approach to aligning internal behavior, how a company or team's members engage each other, to external behavior, how they engage the customer. When the four elements of the business code are aligned, the result is the beauty of business. We can observe it and describe it intellectually. We can experience it and feel it emotionally. We can also see and feel when it is not present. When the components are aligned, the customer experiences satisfaction and trust. When there is misalignment, the customer experiences disappointment, anger, resentment, and mistrust. Similarly, the same experiences are apparent in teams and organizations, and inevitably influence the customer experience. The customer. Jan Moore, an entrepreneur and good friend, says, "Nothing happens until someone sells something, and nothing is sold until you have a customer to sell it to." Jan's assessment has stood the test of time. Without customers, there is no business. Therefore, the first element of the business code is the customer. A customer can be defined narrowly or broadly. Narrowly, a customer is the person who pays for your product or service. Broadly, a customer is any person who buys and receives or is affected by your product or service. Whichever definition you choose, a business requires customers, at least one. Too often, companies fail to clearly articulate and communicate who their customer is and what is at the center of that relationship. One aspect of either description that is evident and doesn't change is that customers are people. In consumer markets, that's obvious. In business-to-business markets and transactions, where the customer is another company or business, it's important to remember that the buying decisions are still made by people, whether it's one person or a group of people. In business-to-business selling, it's important to know who the decision-makers are. All customers make decisions based on a combination of logic and emotion. While we have an incredible ability to think logically, we act out of emotion. Beneath the surface are human desires, the root causes that motivate our actions. Understanding how these motivations affect a customer's decision to buy a particular product or service is at the core of creating customer satisfaction. For example, a customer buying a car has many options. He may visit dealerships in search of the car of his dreams, a BMW or an Audi sports sedan or convertible. He not only wants to feel that he is accomplished enough to afford such a car, including the higher insurance rates and maintenance costs, he also wants to look and feel as if he can drive a car capable of fast acceleration. Emotionally, it's an important part of the image he wishes to present. He wants to test drive the available models to make sure they have an impressive sound system, the color is just right, and that he looks good in it. He expects to pay more to get what he wants, even if he has to order and wait for it. He has enough of a down payment to get into the car, yet is also considering a lease. He may be willing to make some compromises to get the car more quickly, yet is mindful not to let the allure of immediate gratification get in the way of getting it just right. Another car shopper goes online, and rather than look for the car of his dreams, looks for something reliable at the best price. He visits sites that offer efficiency and effectiveness and allow him to make the fastest, most accurate comparisons. Relative to what he is willing to spend, he has a sizable down payment and plans to pay the loan off as quickly as he can. While color and sound system may be considerations, they are not deal breakers. He is looking for the best price on a low cost of ownership vehicle with high fuel efficiency and looks for an apples to apples comparison. He may be willing to make some compromises to get a car more quickly, yet getting the lowest price is foremost. Both customers want to be satisfied with their choice. Each has clear criteria by which they define success. Each considers price and wants to get the most for his money. Yet their perspectives on what they're willing to spend and the value associated with it differ. One wants to look and feel good about being able to afford the car. The other wants to feel that he made the best choice of a car that fits his price. They take different routes to shopping and buying and have different approaches to how they will interact with the provider of their prospective cars. Each takes on similar yet different decisions, and each wants to feel satisfied with his experience. They may have similar ideas about what good customer service is, yet they have different expectations about the level of attention or knowledge they will receive from the seller. While they both may seek financing, they likely have different requirements. Both customers are buying cars. We can readily see how they are alike. Relative to the particular car, each is shopping for a good deal and looking to get the most for his money. Each has requirements and criteria on which to base his decision. They are both motivated to shop and buy. We can also see how they are different. They have different tastes, dissimilar styles, conflicting perspectives on value, and divergent buying habits. While they are both motivated, they are differently motivated. If we look more closely at each customer, we will likely find that the sources of their motivation, the desire each is fulfilling through the purchase of a car, are different. In business, nothing is more important than understanding customer motivation. Although you may begin creating a new product or service without interfacing with a customer, you eventually find yourself seeing the customer at the core of your business. Even if you're like Steve Jobs, who believed that Apple would lead the customer, you still rely on customers for your success. The difference is how you go about it. To know what the customer wants and how to deliver it, you have to understand what motivates their behavior. To know this, just look at yourself. We are all customers and are motivated by a basic set of needs. This is why you are able to identify with the two car buyers. In the next chapter, we will explore what these motivations are and how to use them to better understand who customers are, why they act the way they do, and how to please them best. Alignment starts with the customer. Brand intention. The next element of the business code depends on the first and is leveraged by our understanding of what motivates the customer. I call it brand intention. Brand intention is the thoughtful and deliberate delivery, through a product or service, of a promise to the customer. Over the last several decades, we've devised many ways to define a brand, including market differentiator, value proposition, competitive advantage, mission, purpose, and value add. Although brands were developed as symbols to distinguish one cattle owner's livestock from another's, it's used in business as a means to differentiate one provider's product or service through a name, trademark, or logo. Brand statements typically represent promises and offers. How we receive them differs from how we experience intention. Promises are statements that are made. Intention is how the specific purpose is delivered. Intention is your perception of how well I deliver on my promise. It is the outcome of thoughtful and deliberate behavior. Beyond a statement of promise, brand intention goes further. It answers the question, why is the customer spending their money with us and not our competitor? It speaks not just to the promise, it also captures how customers experience the way the promise is delivered and the resulting level of trust. From a customer's perspective, brand intention reflects the quality of purposefulness through which the product or service is delivered. Brand intention is so powerful because it fulfills a customer's desires and motivation. This is an important aspect of alignment. The brand intention tells the customer, at a conscious or subconscious level, that the need they are seeking to fill will be met. As we'll further explore in Chapter 4, each of the six distinct brand intentions connects to and delivers in response to an aspect of motivation. When an organization or team is aligned with its brand intention to the promise and how it is delivered, the customer experiences it on an emotional level. This makes it a powerful source of competitive advantage. Culture. The third element of the business code is culture, which for several very good reasons often presents some of the most challenging aspects of alignment. First, most leaders and the members of their teams and organizations struggle to define their culture. Second, most leaders are not trained or given the knowledge and skills to lead a culture effectively. As a result, they are left to teach themselves. Thus, most of their ability in this critical aspect of leadership is the result of trial and error. Third, leaders tend to define their cultures by communicating its values and beliefs. While this is important, it's rarely articulated in a way that creates an understanding of how things should be done. This causes confusion and conflict over issues of role definition, power and influence, compensation and reward, decision-making, and the management of disagreements. Culture defines how people treat one another, including the patterns and norms of behavior that members engage in at an individual and group level to achieve success. Culture defines acceptable and unacceptable behavior. When we talk about getting the right people onto the bus, culture describes what the bus looks like and how the people on it are expected to act. One aspect of great businesses is the alignment of internal behaviors to the external experience of the customer, and culture is the key influencer of how the customer is treated. When this alignment occurs, it creates incredible power. This is the power conveyed by the alignment of Apple's culture to the experience of a customer visiting one of its over 400 worldwide retail locations. Apple places enormous emphasis on the expertise and competencies of its employees. Apple's culture emphasizes its capability to innovate and the degree to which its employees are expected to show their passion and expertise in everything they do. The company claims to be amazing and requires its retail sales employees to be analytical, tech-savvy, and insightful. It demands that they learn, develop, and inspire, that they be amazing. These expectations are not lost on the customer. From the moment you walk into an Apple store, an employee, acting as an expert guide, asks you why you were there and connects you with the person who has the knowledge to best help you. Behind each employee is a learning and development plan that is reviewed vigorously and which the employee must achieve to meet the expectations of the culture. The benefit results from advancing the employee's expertise and providing a positive customer experience. This is alignment. It is rare that the employee engaging a customer does not know how to answer the question or solve the problem. Yet, if they can't, they'll quickly connect you with someone who can. A key aspect of the alignment of culture to brand intention and the customer is that how members of an organization or team behave toward one another is how the customer is treated. As an Apple employee, learning and developing is expected, and managers and employees are continuously engaged in that process. It is aligned to the approach they take with their customers. If an employee is not committed to this endeavor and is not willing to continuously...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.